Hello and welcome to Money Life. This is Sucheta Dilal. We are going to talk about the way the National Stock Exchange came to a grinding halt on the 24th of February. So over a week since then, I'm told that the Finance Ministry has actually called a meeting today as we are recording this, which is 4th of March. But other than that, there is very little that we know about what really happened that day. There are lots of conspiracy theories among trader networks. There have been losses and a shockingly inaccurate press release from the Securities and Exchange Board of India, which is a market regulator, a sort of press release from the National Stock Exchange giving convenient facts but not answering all our questions. We at Money Life have sent a detailed questionnaire to SEBI and to NSE, and we haven't got answers. This is the background in which this video blog is being recorded. So we are making some statements, asking some questions, and remember, we have waited for a week for answers. If we had the answers from these two, first line regulator and the market regulator, they would have been part of this blog. But they haven't bothered to respond. In fact, SEBI put out an inaccurate press release which said interoperability between exchanges worked. Now, before we come to any of that, let's look at what we are talking about. NSE is the largest derivatives market in the world and the third largest market in the world when it comes to cash and derivatives, especially on the cash side. So we're talking about something which is of global standards. It's been controversial in the last 4-5 years, but has been seen as a well-run, professionally run exchange, which is supposed to have introduced all the checks and balances that the capital market system required when it was set up in 1992. It's come a long way since then. What happened on that day was that when the market came to a slow grinding halt, and I'm coming to that a little later, NSE just decided to close trading. It reopened it for an extended session sometime in the afternoon at around 3:48, but without giving enough notice, by which time big brokers had squared off open positions and caused enormous losses to people for no fault of theirs. As one of the brokers, Zerodha, has gone public saying, if we knew that the exchange was going to open, we would probably not have done the squaring up. The more important thing is that a couple of years ago, SEBI put in place rules which said that if one exchange has a problem, because clearing corporations of both exchanges will have interoperability, which means that margins which are deposited with one exchange could be switched to another exchange, in this case the Bombay Stock Exchange, and things would continue smoothly because traders would not have had to be squared off, they would have switched. More importantly, and this is over 2 decades old, NSE has always told us that it's got a disaster recovery site. Now, all big, highly technical, large financial organizations like this need it. It's a disaster recovery site. Now, NSE has said that its disaster recovery site can be started in 45 minutes. And we hear that, you know, for 5 years in the middle, there was nothing, no testing happening. But under SEBI rules, this has to be tested every quarter, and twice a year, NSE is supposed to operate from the disaster recovery site and send in reports. This gets kick-started within 45 minutes. On the 24th of February, the management of NSE took a decision not to start it. We have no answers why. NSE has also gone on record to say that it had a telecom issue and two of the telecom providers had said that they had instability. Unfortunately, there are lots of doubts and questions about all of this. The Business Standard recently reported that SEBI's Technical Advisory Committee, headed by Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala of IIT Madras, is going to look at it. Professor Jhunjhunwala is an absolutely upright, no-nonsense person, and we're quite certain that he will ask tough questions and get to the bottom of it. But the Business Standard story also says he is going to fix accountability and report to a whole-time member of SEBI. This is rather strange if you ask me. As you know, we have covered in various video blogs the algo scam that happened, that was unearthed in 2015 by MoneyLife. In that scam, till now, no accountability has been fixed, even though four small committees mandated by the TSE have looked into it. So the TSE itself appointed 2 IIT professors, which is called the SEBI TSE committee. There's an Ernst & Young report, there's a Deloitte forensic report, and a report by ISB Hyderabad. no accountability has been pinned. So you have general punishments giving general responsibility, no specific person has been held accountable. Why is it going to be different this time? And if the TAC did not get into the job of fixing accountability for a big algo scam, why will it agree to do it this time? So the report in Business Standard, whoever gave it to them, raises more questions than it answers. But I have no doubt that Professor Jhunjhunwala is going to get to at least the truth of what is happening about the contradictory SEBI reports. Now, if you ask me, since SEBI itself rushed to come out on the side of the exchange and put out an inaccurate press release and did not bother to follow any standard operating procedures. Now, remember, these are not standard operating procedures cooked up by our Indian regulator over here or an exchange. There is an international organization of securities commissions called IOSCO. And IOSCO looks very closely at what happens and how to deal globally when there is such a glitch or a cyber attack or stoppage of any kind in markets, and what needs to be the standard operating procedure. One thing is very, very clear, which is that there have to be announcements all the time. Tell the people what happened. You have a fixed, in fact, there are circuit breakers. There are times at which the market has to remain closed. So if it hits a certain circuit, the market has to be shut for 1 hour. So when there's a bigger glitch like this, there are standard operating procedures about how the market will be restarted, what kind of announcements will be made, and whatever you do, you have to take care of the interests of investors and traders, because they are the ones who make up the market. Why was all this forgotten? So frankly, SEBI is as culpable, because SEBI's press release has told us that we were constantly in touch with the NSE. But no sooner that the market opened on the 25th, SEBI has asked for a root cause analysis. SEBI has asked why the disaster recovery didn't work. But hello, weren't you in touch with NSE officers throughout the day? So if anything, the TAC should actually act independently and should be answering the finance ministry. Remember when SEBI told us interoperability worked, and it even put out numbers, 40,000 crores of trading on the BSE to indicate that it worked. It is Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman who actually gave us the truth when she said in public that interoperability did not work. So if TAC is going to look into it, in my view, TAC should report to the finance ministry. Now let's look at every bit of what happened that day and analyze it. So one is, why did the market close down? There are those experts connected with markets who point out that all large financial systems, banks are constantly attacked by hackers and have to be perpetually one jump ahead to prevent cyber attacks. That's why they invest humongous amounts in technology and are on their toes all the time. So they say that in NSE's case, one expert tells us it has all the signs of a slow moving train wreck. These are his words. And why does he say that? Because he says things didn't stop all of a sudden. So if there was a telecom problem, things would have just come to a halt if there's something like a cable cut. He points out, if you look at the public domain, then the problem started much earlier. It started around 9:54 when the first tweets from traders began to appear. And there's one that we are showing you right here. And then slowly, one by one, its system seemed to fold up. So by 10:06, the problem had affected other parts of NSE system. Then its stock indices stopped getting updated. While people were beginning to complain about that, we heard that the Clearing Corporation had a problem. And it seems to have had a problem because Clearing Corporation shut down. The Clearing Corporation is key to this business about interoperability between two exchanges. Finally, at 11:11 a.m., that NSE actually began to say that things look like it's shutting down. In fact, it was 1 hour and 40 minutes when one by one things shut down. Apparently some currency expiry also happened before that. And NSE closed the derivatives market at 11:40 and the cash market at 11:43 with an unexplained gap of 3 minutes. Now, why 3 minutes doesn't seem like a long time for a layperson, but when you look at the fact that 95% of trading happens through algorithms. The biggest trades which create these lakhs of crores of daily turnover come from algos and high frequency trading, which happens in microseconds and milliseconds, fractions of a second. 3 minutes is an enormously long time, and over a week, no questions asked. This is our point, that root cause analysis can't take forever. The slow shutdown, like we said, may be a cyber attack, according to people. This is pure speculation at the moment, but not empty speculation, because remember when Maharashtra had this very, very unexplained huge closure in October 2020, it is only much later now that the Minister for Power in Maharashtra has suddenly admitted that it was a Chinese cyber attack, as reported by the New York Times based on an independent study. Still discussions about it, but let's not rule out a cyber attack. We're not saying it is, but we don't know what happened. So now let's come to telecom failure that NSE talks about. Two telecom providers said there is instability. Now everybody, and I eavesdropped on a couple of conversations with tech experts, and nobody believes NSE when it says there was a telecom failure, because they say there's a ring arrangement which connects one system to another. More importantly, what people in the market say is that 95% of all orders are sourced within the colo of the NSE. 65% of all trades also come from colocation servers, which is within the NSE building. So if there was telecom instability, they would be the first to report that we can't load. So orders froze initially, but there were no big complaints. Nothing happened on the BSC, and there were no complaints about telecom failure except in NSE's press release. NSE has not elaborated on it. So now let's come to the third part, which is interoperability and disaster recovery. I've told you what it means already. Now, this is the 10th trading glitch at the NSE, which means the disaster recovery should have been on standby at least 10 times in the last 4 years, ready for it to switch. It has not had to do it. These things are reported. What do the reports say? There are quarterly reports. Was there a reason why the management took a decision, obviously with SEBI, not to start it? There are three questions that I would like to raise. One, interoperability between exchanges would have allowed a switch to the Bombay Stock Exchange. It did not happen because NSE clearing was shut. We don't know why. SOPs with regard to market opening, keeping market participants informed, and providing enough notice and to avoid losses did not happen. And NSE failed to switch to the DR, which ostensibly SEBI monitors every quarter, and it did not work. Both NSE and SEBI, like I said, are equally responsible here, because they claim they were constantly in touch. On March 1, they say that SEBI held a meeting to look at what happened with clearing corporations, but it's not looking at disaster recovery. My sources say that colo servers, which are the backbone and give a lot of fees and income to the NSE, are not replicated at the disaster site, which means that on 25th, which was the expiry day, the colos would have lost a lot of their advantage. Some say that this doesn't matter, because when all colos lose their advantage, they're on par. Some say that when large traders are trading only through algorithms and the colo servers, their systems are configured in a certain manner, they can't suddenly switch to manual trading. We don't know what it is. We need the regulator and the technical advisory committee to tell us what happened. But this is the 10th glitch, mind you. Even issues like what happens to people who operate from colos, that is the high frequency traders, is something that should already have been looked at and ironed out long ago. So my suggestion is that you need the technical advisory committee looking into it. You need accountability fixed at least this time. You didn't do it during the algo trading, but let the TAC report directly to the finance ministry. The finance ministry has called a meeting today. The SEBI chairman is also there. Let's hope they take this decision. Thank you. If you like what you hear, spread the word, subscribe to us, ask others to listen. Thank you.